Grace to you and peace in the name of God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. How wonderful it is for us to be back together on this day as we celebrate the joy of an empty tomb. A couple things I want to remind you about this time of worship. We're still honoring social distancing and masks. You are able, however, to sing your heart out while you have your mask on. And so I encourage you to do that as we give thanks for this particular day. In the early church, when Easter arrived, Christians would greet each other with a call and response. And as they would say, the Lord is risen. And in response, what he risen is indeed. Let's in good Trinitarian fashion do that three times. The Lord is risen. The Lord is risen.
He is risen.
The Lord is risen.
He is risen.
Let us celebrate the one who made that happen.
To worship that found in your bulletin. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad.
Thank you.
Scripture tells us that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Let us now confess our sin to God and to one another, and then in silence, let us pray together. God of everlasting life, we confess that we continue in the ways of death. You have announced your new creation, but we put our hope in former things. You have opened the door of the tomb, but we close our hearts to our neighbors. Forgive us, God of grace. Make us people of the resurrection, proclaiming the destruction of death and the glorious gift of new life in you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. Christ our Savior gave himself for us that he might redeem us from our sin and claim us as his own people. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Our scripture lesson this day offers Luke's account of the event that we celebrate again all of these centuries later, coming from the 24th chapter, beginning with the first verse. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now, it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths by themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. At this point, we'd invite the children to come and to join me up front for our time together this morning. So good to see all of you this morning. Happy Easter to you. Before I want to talk to you about this box and what it tells us about Jesus, I want to show you my socks this morning. I need someone who can read to tell me what this sock says. Stop COVID. Right. And so you see this virus with this X through it, and that's what all of you are doing with your masks on and helping make sure we all stay safe. We're stopping COVID. But it's so good for us to be here together today. Easter is my favorite day of the year. It's the most important day in our life as Christians. And a minute ago, I read to you the story that came from the very first Easter and want to tell you of what happened on that day. So we're told that a group of women went to the tomb very early. The sun was just coming up when they got there.
And they had gone there because they were very sad that Jesus had died. And they wanted to do one final thing as an act of love for him. Well, when they got there, they found the tomb. And this is my own version of the tomb here. And the thing that you need to know about the tomb when Jesus was buried was that there was this really big stone that went in front of it, that was rolled over. I don't have that stone here for you. Instead, what you have is now sort of the entrance to the tomb. You see here? So this is where they came in. So they walk up, and they're expecting the stone still to be there, and it's gone. And so they decide they're going to go inside to see what's happened. And when they get in there, Jesus isn't there. But what happens is a big surprise. So let me show you. So, suddenly, when they were in the tomb, two people appeared. They weren't bears. Two people appeared. And we're not told exactly what angels look like, so I think it's okay for me to have a bear here, right? Because we don't know what the angels look like. And the women are, of course, scared. They think, what is going on here? And the angels start telling them the story. They tell them that Jesus has been raised from the dead. And they remind them of something Jesus had told them, because Jesus had said that this was going to happen. And so when the women hear that, they go and they tell all the other disciples, and word begins to spread as they told others and they told others, and eventually the word got to you and me. We're here today because of the women who went inside that tomb and they heard this amazing message. And so I'm going to give you something that I want you to take with you to help remember this part of the story. I want each of you to have one of these little stones. These stones are much smaller than the ones that would have been in front of Jesus' tomb. But I want you to take one of these with you, and when you get home later today, maybe to bring out some paint or some markers or some crayons, and I'd like you to decorate these stones. And then, here's the thing that you do next. Just like that stone told us that Jesus had been raised, and the women went and told other people about it, after you decorate this stone, I'd like for you to go and give it to someone too. Maybe someone who wasn't able to be with us this morning, but someone who also needs to know that Jesus has been raised. Everyone have one? So, you have one too? Okay, you got one. All right. So, here to give you some ideas. I did not paint these, but you here see one. It's painted. Looks like an Easter egg. And how about this one? A ladybug, right? So you get to use your imagination as you paint or color these stones, and then give them to someone else as a way of telling them that Jesus has been raised. So let's pray together, and if you'd repeat after me, dear God. Thank you for raising Jesus. Thank you for those who told that story. Help us share it too. In his name we pray. Amen. Now, after the service today too, if you want to come back and have your photo taken with this angel, feel free to do that. Please join me in prayer.
We give thanks, O God, for that wonderful news that was discovered in your son's tomb long ago, and for the way those first disciples began to share it. We pray that on this day, gathering all of these years later, that led by your Spirit, that news might become new once more, and that we will be transformed by it as we live our days out as Easter people. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. During the season of Lent that just was completed, we spent time in worship focusing on women who were part of Jesus' ministry. Over those weeks together, we read about women who offered acts of hospitality to Jesus and others who provided the financial means for him and his disciples as they traveled. We learned of other women who displayed great faith and insight and courage, often in sharp contrast to some of the men who were part of those same events. We have been focusing in this season on the Gospel of Luke because he by far has the most accounts of the roles that women played in that ministry of long ago. And yet, when it comes to Easter, Luke is like all the other gospel writers in affirming that it was women who first heard and then shared that good news. In the account that we heard read moments ago, the women have gone to that tomb early on that Sunday morning. Their intention was to carry out one final act of devotion, to anoint his lifeless body for its eternal rest. And yet when they arrive, they find that this massive stone that had been rolled in front of the tomb late on that Friday, that it now had been rolled aside. And they go in. The body is not there. And they're beginning to try to understand what they're seeing when suddenly we are told that two men appear. Luke only says they're in dazzling clothes. I'm guessing a little bit more elaborate than our bear friend here. The women, of course, realize that something divine is happening here, and they're terrified, and they bow their heads. And it is then that the angels in one voice say, "Why are you looking for the living among why are you looking for the dead among the living? He is not here. He has been raised. Remember how he told you while you were in Galilee that he would be handed over to the sinful people, that he would be put to death, and on the third day he would be raised again." Those angels are citing really a verse that we can find in the 9th chapter of Luke. It comes just after Peter has identified Jesus truly as the Messiah, and Jesus offers the first of what is a number of predictions of what's going to happen to him when he finally gets to Jerusalem. In this particular moment in the tomb, however, the angels aren't asking the women to quote scripture, but to remember a moment when they were present. "Remember how he told you," they begin. Given these confusing events that are happening in front of them, I think it's remarkable they even can remember their name. And yet, they do recall those words. But Luke says, they remembered. And then they left the tomb and went and told the 11 and all the rest what had happened. And only then does the gospel writer identify for us those women. And it's Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and then others. Among all the wondrous details found in that narrative, I was struck as I read it again of what triggered the Easter celebration. It came when those women were asked if they remembered what Jesus had already told them. And when they did, that's when they went and shared the news. The first Easter occurred because of remembrance. And that remains true for this one, too. As there's all kind of remembrance that's happening for us in this gathering. For members of this church, looking around the hillside is a time of remembering just some of the special people who make up your family of faith. For those of you who are worshiping with us for the first time, your presence brings us added joy as you have remembered the invitation of a friend, or perhaps hearing about it through social media. For many of us, this day evokes memories of previous Easters, gathered in a packed sanctuary or bundled up against the cold at a sunrise service. And for all of us, this day causes us to remember all that we've gone through in the last 14 months, the losses, the restrictions that we have all had to experience and endure, and how even now the presence of masks and social distancing makes clear we're not yet out of this pandemic. Remembrance fills this gathering. And yet the reality is, for all of us, there are pieces of what we remember to which we need to add new truths. The story is told, for instance, of a children's Sunday school teacher who was concerned that with all the commercialization of Easter, with bunnies and eggs and so forth, that the real meaning of the day had been lost upon the children. And so on that particular Sunday, as the class comes together, she said, "Can anyone tell me what today is called?" And in one voice they shout, "Easter." She says, "Wonderful. Now, can you tell me what Easter is all about?" One girl's frantically waving her hand, and the teacher calls on her, and she says, "Easter is when Jesus was born, and we give presents to each other." And the teacher gently said, "No, dear, that's Christmas." Another little boy named Bobby said, I know, and so the teacher called on him, and he said, "Easter is when we get dressed up in costumes and go to people's house and they give us candy." She said, no, that's Halloween. "Can anyone tell me what Easter is about?" Finally, Susie, the child who knew all of the answers when teachers asked, raised her hand and she says, "I can." And so Susie begins. "Easter was when Jesus died and he was put in a tomb." And the teacher smiles as Susie goes on to say, and an angel came and rolled the stone back away 3 days later." And the teacher says, "Right, Susie, that's right. Tell us how it finished." And Susie went ahead and said, "Jesus came out of his tomb. And if he sees his shadow, there's only 6 more weeks of winter." Even in the land of Punxsutawney Phil, I'm confident that our children know the story better than that. And yet what it does remind us is that all of us, no matter what our age, need to be reminded or to learn of what Jesus taught. One New Testament professor, in writing about that particular scene, put it this way: "Remembering is often the activating of the power of recognition. For this reason alone, it is most important that the teacher and preacher share with the listeners the story of Jesus and the church. Such recitals may not strike fire at the time or be heard as matters of burning relevance. However, the time will come when the congregation will remember, and it will make all the difference. Such was the case for those women in that empty tomb of long ago. And that scholar concludes, one cannot remember what one has not heard. It's with that counsel in mind that I would like to share with you some of the things that Jesus told us. This will not be an exhaustive list, but it is representative of the kinds of things he shared during those 3 years that he walked this earth. And thus, I want to lift up for you some of his words, either to remind you of what he told us, or to help you hear for the first time something about the kind of life that he means for you and me to experience. For it is Jesus who said, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And it was the same one who, as part of one of his first sermons, said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." It was Jesus who said, "Pray then in this way, our Father who art in heaven." And he was the one who said, "Let the children come to me, for such of these is the kingdom of God." It was Jesus who said, "Come unto me, all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." And it was Jesus who said, "I am the bread of life." It was Jesus who said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you." And who said, "A new commandment I give you, that you are to love one another." It was Jesus who said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son." And Jesus said, "Do not be afraid." It was Jesus who, as part of a Thursday night long ago, said, "Do this in remembrance of me," and who hours later on the cross prayed, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing." And after all of those events, it was Jesus who said, "Go into all the world making disciples." And who in his final words said, "Remember, I am with you always to the end of the age." On that first Easter, some messengers of God asked, "Do you remember what he told you?" And in response, some women not only recalled, but they went out and told others. Sounds to me like the perfect response for us on this Easter too. Let us pray. We remain humbled, O God, after all of these years of celebrating the joy of Easter, to be reminded once more of what you brought about in that moment. We pray as your disciples that we might continue to trust and to act upon all that you have taught us, that we might then continue to share it with the world still in need of his truth. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
what is printed in the bulletin. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed and blessing the church, healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, and delivering us from death to life eternal. Please be seated. There are a few joys and concerns to share and a few announcements. We give joy this day. We want to remember the anniversary of Craig and Nancy Eaton, who last year celebrated their 50th anniversary, but this year are celebrating their 51st. We also want to remember in prayer this week as we pray for Jan Frank, who will be having surgery on Monday, and Kathy McCourty's mother, who is recovering from a broken hip. We will be celebrating communion in a few minutes. If you have not received elements, there are elements up on the front table. You're welcome to come and pick them up. I want to share another joy, a joy of the congregation, as we welcome Carrie Bierman. Carrie, please stand. Carrie is the new director of Tweens and Teens. She has a big job ahead of us, learning all our names, especially when we're wearing masks.
Pray for me.
Welcome. Another fun thing we have for today, you might see over by the tree over there, there is a beautifully decorated picture frame. If you would like to have your picture taken in that frame, you can go over after service, and of course, Mr. Bear is here for photos as well. Hope that you received the email from John this week, the good news, Lord willing. May 2nd, we're going to come back to worship together in the sanctuary. Yes, may it be so. May it be so. We also have a minute for mission this morning, and I'd like to invite representatives from the youth and also from the mission committee to share with you some good news.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Erin Risk, and we're here this morning to update you on your efforts to support the mission outreach of DPC. Throughout the past pandemic year, the Mission Committee has continued their work maintaining contact with our mission partners, which number over 25, allocating mission dollars, which are currently 10% of our total operating budget, and determining funding for 2021. As we're all very aware, we've had limited opportunity for hands-on mission work with COVID restrictions and limited gatherings this year. Despite that, the community meal shifted to a prepackaged meal distribution in conjunction with Code Blue and the YMCA. Volunteers participated in rolling harvest gleanings throughout the summer. A small cadre of DPC workers completed several days of work in New Jersey with the St. Bernard Project this past fall. We oversaw a virtual giving tree and Advent market, and we began a drive-by food donation program for the Doylestown Food Pantry.
Thank you. Oh, thank you.
One of the relatively unseen missions of the church came to a complete halt with the interruption in church attendance. Many of you faithfully and silently kept the food bin collection in the Mechanic Street lobby overflowing every week. At the same time, food insecurity in our area gradually began to increase with changes in job status for those in our community. Local food pantries also had to shift how food was sorted and distributed in their small gathering spaces.
In November, in response to the increasing local and regional needs, we added a drive-by food collection to one of our meal distribution days and had a terrific response, collecting 600 pounds of products. December's collection saw additional helping hands, with our youth now participating with unloading cars, and donations totaled 700 pounds. In January, we shifted our collection location from the alley up to Mechanic Street for more room. The youth are now managing the collection, unloading donations, sorting and boxing all products, checking expiration dates, and reloading for delivery. This process is a great help to the receiving organizations. Over 1,000 pounds was delivered to Caring for Friends in January. And in February, another 1,100 pounds went back to the Doylestown Pantry. Due to your generous donations, our March collection of another 1,000 pounds was divided between the Doylestown Pantry and the New Britain Larder. This past year, we have all seen and experienced many pivots in how we navigate our everyday activities. Despite intermittent frustrations, we have had many opportunities to rethink and improve upon some things we might never have looked at otherwise. Our food collection process has been nothing short of bountiful, thanks to all that are providing. In continuing to work together, we have reusable grocery bags for you to take shopping with you and fill out the store. Simply bring the bags back on collection day, and we will empty and return them to you. Feel free to take several and share with neighbors and family. Please stop by our table on your way out to pick up your bags. If you feel inspired to organize a small collection in your neighborhood, please reach out to any of the mission committee. We'd be happy to help with picking up donations. We are also accepting $5 gift cards to Walmart, Wawa, Wendy's, and Burger King for the Code Blue clients. And we readily welcome any youth who want to join in our receiving and sorting the third Sunday of the month. No RSVP required, just show up. As a congregation who is actively seeking to expand mission opportunities and at the same time exploring the Matthew 25 initiative, we will close with Matthew 25, verse 35. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. Thank you.
Thank you.
What a generous congregation you are, and there are more opportunities even today as we collect the one great hour of sharing offering, which goes to our denomination. There is a wooden box over on the table if you brought that offering or any other offering for the congregation. We are blessed.
Even as we feed others, we are fed. And we gather in this moment to remember that meal that our Lord established long ago. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, eternal God, creator and ruler of the universe. At your word, the earth was made and spun on its course among the planets. Your hand formed us from the dust of the earth and set us among all your creatures to love and serve you. When we were unfaithful to you, you kept faith with us. When we were slaves in Egypt, you broke the bonds of our oppression, brought us through the sea to freedom, and made covenant to be our God. By a pillar of fire, you led us through the desert to a land flowing with milk and honey and set before us the way of life. You spoke of love and justice in the prophets, and in the Word made flesh, you lived among us, manifesting your glory. He died that we might live and is risen to raise us to new life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name. God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, whom you sent to save us. He came with healing in his touch and was wounded for our sins. He came with mercy in his voice and was mocked as one despised. He came with peace in his heart and met with violence and death. By your power, he broke free from the prison of the tomb. And at his command, the gates of hell were opened. The one who was dead now lives. The one who humbled himself is raised to rule over all creation, the Lamb upon the throne. The one ascended on high is with us always, as he promised. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, and upon these your gifts of bread and cup, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. In this moment, too, O God, we stop and lift before you those that we know are in need of your healing, in particular for Jan and for Barbara. We lift before you all those who grieve this day, all those who long to be together once more and yet are unable to do so. Break down all that separates us, O God, that we might experience with faithful hearts your enduring love and presence. Nourished at this table, O God, may we know Christ's redemptive love and live a new life in him. Give us who are fed at his hand grace to share our bread with the hungry and with the hungry of heart. All this we ask, remembering that prayer that he taught his first disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors.
and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. It was on the night that Jesus was betrayed that he took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner also, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, as we have done in his name on this morning, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's saving death until he comes again." Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us commune together. Living Christ, as you open the scriptures to us, you make yourself known in the breaking of the bread. Let us now go forth from this place, fed at your table and filled by the Spirit, to walk with you all the days of our lives and to proclaim the glory of your resurrection to all the world. For it is in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
out, enjoy celebrating the beauty of this day and the gift of life you have received in Christ. Celebrate once more the good news that came in a tomb. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and sustain you on this day and forevermore.